In the practice of modeling, certain patterns arise, and what I propose now to do is to take a look at some of them that arise quite often and are important in building models of any reasonable size. First, I'd like to turn to the problem of how to represent the type or kind of something. How do we go about saying that something is of a particular kind? We call it kind or type, that's fine. We can do it either using the attribution mechanism or the instantiation classification mechanism. And the question is, which one to prefer? Take the example of a person and quoting the information about the gender of a person. The first thing that comes to mind is to say, okay, let us assign an attribute gender. Say that a person has gender with a range in the values of biological genders, and say, quoting that ET is a person of female gender, can be declared by quoting ET as an instance of person with value female for the property gender. That's fine if this is all the information we want to give concerning the gender of person ET. Now, if there is more information that might be given about ET because it is of a particular gender, that would not have been possible using the attribution pattern that we used before. The alternative way would have been to distinguish two subclasses of person, man and woman. These are two subclasses defined by gender, of course. And then, in that case, we can quote that ET is an instance of woman, and this conveys the same information as before. But now we can also convey some more information if we like. So if, for instance, the number of pregnancies of a woman is being recorded, an integer number, we can say that ET is a woman that has had 5 pregnancies. This is a kind of information that would have been impossible to render using the attribute structure before, just because the information there ends with the statement that ET is a female, and there is no other information we can give about it because it is a female. So the moral is that if we just want to declare the type of something, then doing it using an attribute is fine. If we want to provide further information that is type dependent, then this means that it is better to assign the type by instantiating an appropriate class, because it is at that class that we will find the particular properties that will be the carriers of the extra information that we need. Consider now again the example of the person with the scientist and athlete subclasses that we saw before. And an entity AB, which is declared to be an instance of scientist and an instance of athlete at the same time. As we have seen, multiple classification is possible, so we can make this declaration. And AB, being a scientist, has specialty archaeology, and being an athlete, exercises the sport scuba diving. Now, doing this is fine if all you want is to give information about a specific entity AB, and the easiest way to do this is to recognize that this is a scientist and this is an athlete. So we just take the information that we need from scientist, specialty, the information we need from athlete, exercises, and that's it. Now, this was fine in order to characterize instances ad hoc. So multiple classification is fine for the ad hoc characterization of instances. Now, reconsider the case of submarine archaeologist. Remember that submarine archaeologist is subclass of both archaeologist and scuba diver. Archaeologist is a subclass of scientist, and scuba diver is a subclass of athlete. Declaring AB as an instance of submarine archaeologist conveys the same information as before. We know that AB is an archaeologist and is a scuba diver. So at a first look, we might say that the two were equivalent ways of conveying information. But in fact, this second practice of using multiple generalization is a practice that we will employ not if we just want to provide an ad hoc information about the person AB, but if we want to have a more systematic characterization of persons that are submarine archaeologists. So it is a recurring situation We have submarine archaeologists. It is not just one that happened to exercise scuba diving and archaeology at the same time. And in this case, what we need is to declare a class, and that will be the vehicle for having a systematic characterization of entities by as belonging to this class. So the difference between using multiple generalization and multiple classification in a given situation does not really lie in the quantity or the specific information that you may give for any single instance, but rather it has to do with the need of flexibly characterizing instances ad hoc or systematically characterizing instances in a particular domain. We now turn to another pattern that occurs very, very frequently, and this is the representation of part-whole relations, that is, convey the information that an object is composed of other objects, or that an object is part of some bigger one. To convey the information that an object has parts, has other objects as parts, or that an object is part of another object, is quite elementary, I might say, in terms of devising a schema. We just need to have the entity class object and the property has part from object to object. This is enough for the ad hoc declaration of objects with a has part relation between them. And in fact, because the has part relation in the real world is a transitive relation. Transitive means that engine 1 has cylinder 1, cylinder 2, cylinder 3, etc. And engine 1 has ignition unit, the ignition unit 1. So to keep this kind of information, we need to name the relationships between car and body, car and engine, engine and cylinder, engine and ignition differently. It would not be enough to say we just declare a has part relation on car and that car has part body and has part engine, because if we do this, we will just lose the information that engine 1 is the engine of car 1 and cylinder 1 is a cylinder in engine 1. To do this, we declare has body, has engine, has cylinder and has ignition unit as subclass of has part. That is, with the idea that properties may be subclasses of or subproperties of other properties, having cylinders and an ignition unit. And of course, there are other parts that are not shown here. And we'd like to keep the information that a certain item, which is a body of a car, is used as the body of a particular car. And then this particular car also has a specific engine. And the relation between those two is that car 1 has engine 1. So by using the subclass of property and the transitivity of has part, we can define composition properties with domain-specific names. We will use different names to declare the parts of a car than the parts of a ship or of a bicycle. So we can have a completely domain-specific terminology to declare properties, but they will all be properties of the kind has part, and we can, as I said, use the transitivity in order to obtain the composition trees of objects. Now we turn to the question of how to model events and activities. Take the example of a builder that has repaired a house. At first glance, we might say that a model showing the class builder and a property repaired with range house is what we need to say that builder A has done a repair on house B, etc. And for each such repair, we may quote further information, such as what was the cost of the repair, when did the repair start and when did it end, and also if there was a contract or an agreement between the builder and the house owner, what were the terms of the contract that governed this repair. It is absolutely okay to model the repair in this way. On the other hand, the repair of the house was not just an association between a builder and a house. It is an act that took place, and each time that a repair takes place, it is a different act in which a builder takes part in the role of actor and the house takes part in the role of object being repaired. And if we take this approach, then repairs are modeled as entities, and we introduce the entity class repair, instances of which are every single repair that we are recording. Every single repair has at least one actor, one builder being involved, and an object. And of course, the information about cost and terms of contract and beginning and ending date that were given for the relation repaired before are now assigned to the entity repair. At first sight, these two ways of modeling are equivalent. And in fact, we can make them completely equivalent by introducing certain conditions. But the essential thing I want to draw your attention on right now is that it comes a little bit more naturally to talk of acts as entities in their own right. And it also turns out to be easier in terms of implementation of models in various environments and languages to use this construct of modeling the activity as an entity rather than modeling the activity as a property, because in certain environments we may run into difficulties declaring properties of properties, whereas there is no such difficulty when we declare properties of entities in any implementation environment. In order to be able to draw models of some size, we need to change our notation a little bit. So for compactness, we will introduce some notation from UML class diagrams. Classes will be drawn as boxes. The attributes will be listed inside the boxes, and the relations, which are called associations in UML, will be shown as arrows between the boxes. Relations that have attributes of their own are shown as hanging boxes from the arrows. And of course, more symbols are provided in UML for special kinds of relations. I will not care about those here.